Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining me today for The Brain 202, Gardening and Evolving Your Digital Brain. This is a special holiday presentation. As you can see, I've got my Santa hat on. I'm joined by Abominable, who will be keeping an eye on things today. I'm also joined by another fantastic character, Chase Ingersoll. He is going to be answering all of your questions in the GoToMeeting question panel and presenting a few questions at the end of the demo. Now, while we're having a little bit of fun with the holiday themed webinar, we're going to be covering some serious topics. We're going to talk about more advanced features of the brain. You know, the brain can hold all of your digital information, files, documents, passwords, emails, notes, videos, web pages, you name it. If you've got digital content, you can put it into the brain. So it can hold a lot of data, but it does not need to be cumbersome or unwieldy. And today we are going to focus on cleaning things up. That's why we call it doing some gardening within your brain. How to freshen things up within your brain database, review your data, do a little end of year thought review in your content, clean things up so you're fresh and organized and ready for anything that comes your way in the new year. So we're assuming that everyone joining today is familiar with the brain. If you're not, please feel free to remain on the call. You're going to see some great features of the application, but also sign up for a Brain 101 class. That's sort of the stepping stone to get to today's webinar. All the basics behind creating thoughts within your brain, adding files and content. I'm assuming that you're familiar with these processes, and we're going to jump right in to cleaning up existing brain databases. So I have got my own real brain up and running today. And this particular brain, maybe you've seen it, I demo it from time to time, typically on a Brain 101, but I just show real quickly, you know, a couple of key features I like about check boxes in your notes, which I'm going to talk about again today, but take it to the next level. Adding files, web pages, right alongside all of my thoughts and content. But first and foremost, the first thing we're going to do today is get into the holiday spirit. And, you know, I decorate, if you even see my wallpaper back here behind the brain, I decorate my desktop with a holiday theme. I put lights in my yard. I wear my Santa hat from time to time. I'm really getting into the holiday spirit, and your digital brain can be no different. The digital brain is really a reflection of your own organic brain. So why not utilize some of the funner features of the brain application to give yourself a holiday theme or a new wallpaper to motivate you for the new year? And I like to do that by going into options and brain theme. And of course, you can select from one of the many different built-in brain themes that we have. Today, we're going to take it one step further. We're clicking on options, and I am going to select a new wallpaper. So here I've got on my C drive, if I go down to wallpapers, I've got a couple of different wallpapers that I like to use. I'm not seeing anything holiday themed there. Let's go on my C drive. I'm going to wander around a bit. Here's another wallpaper directory that's not really brain specific. And here I've got some really great options. I like these pine cones, actually. I'm going to select that. And that simply becomes my new wallpaper. There's many more features and capabilities here to manipulate if you want a real Christmassy font. For all of your thoughts within the brain, you want to change color codes and links, red links, green links, things like that. You certainly can. I'm just going to add this nice new fresh wallpaper. And over in the content window, here again, I like to run my brain in what we call dark mode. I've got dark themes. It's typically has a completely dark background. But my notes for the brains that I create typically have a dark background with lighter text. Let's change that up a bit. I'm going to click on the notes styles button. And there's once again, a lot you can do in here to customize your brain to fit your own personality, to fit the subject matter of the content that you're working on. And I do this not only to just make the brain unique for me and fit my personality, but each individual brain I create has its own unique background, wallpaper, notes theme, and so on, so that I know just visually which brain I happen to be in when I open that content. So we can meticulously, one by one, thought by thought, you know, the background, if we want to change the weight of those, or even the colors of the titles. So instead of doing the default color, we choose sort of a light green color, something like that. Or we can even select from one of our pre-built styles. So you can find a holiday themed style that really works for you. For this, I'm going to switch from my typical nocturne, my favorite, to just something a little bit lighter to lighten things up. So I'll go with the modern. And that is a universal change throughout your brain. You can also customize and save your own themes there, but that's a universal change. So every thought in your brain has this new color coding, these color coding rules applied to it in this particular brain. As I mentioned earlier, if I click to look at all of my different brain databases, I can tell not just only by the name of the brain, there you can see it changes the thumbnail as well, changing the wallpaper, but that helps me to visually identify the subject matter of that particular brain that I happen to be in. Great, so we've got my holiday theme brain happening now. It's time to start making some big changes for thoughts and notes and content and cleaning things up. Before I do that, since I'm doing sort of a end of year review clean, I might be deleting thoughts or changing and manipulating large groups of thoughts, it's very important to make a backup. Now, your backup within the brain can happen in several different ways. First and foremost, my brain is syncing to the cloud. So you may have seen that auto sync button kick on in the background from time to time. So while I'm editing and modifying my brain, it's syncing to the brain cloud. So I've got that online version. I make a bunch of backups to my brain. I make a bunch of changes to my brain. I don't like what I've done. I can always undo or, you know, maybe even delete that brain and download a new copy from the cloud. However, if your brain is set to sync automatically as you're making those changes, you know, any changes you may have made are now suddenly synced to the cloud. If you've got multiple devices syncing to the cloud, those changes that you just made are being rolled out to all those other devices as soon as they sync. So therefore, it's just a really, really great best practice to get into to make your own brain archive. And to do that, I click on File and select Backup to Brain Archive. There's two radio buttons you need to be familiar with. The first one is the default setting, and that's only you with your account can extract this BRZ file. If anyone else ever gets a hold of this BRZ, you put it on a shared drive or a thumb drive and you lose your thumb drive on the bus, something crazy like that happens, that BRZ is protected with your account information. So it cannot be extracted by anyone else but you with your login credentials, your brain account information. Or if you're making this BRZ specifically so that someone else can have access to a brain that you've created, I'll be doing this today with a smaller subset of this brain, you would certainly select the option to allow anyone to restore. So it doesn't matter what their login credentials are, that's going to be an unlocked BRZ that they can open up and create their own brain from. Now, I'm going to spare you. I'm not going to click on backup because this is my real brain and it's very large. I've got a lot of data in this brain. I think I'm close to 7,000 thoughts. We don't need to be here, you know, chatting away, waiting for that BRZ backup to complete. I did it earlier today. My brain, with the amount of data I have in, takes about 8 to 10 minutes to, and it's not really about the thought count, it's about the files and attachments and videos and graphics and so forth that are included in that brain. So here it is on my desktop. You can see by default, when you create a BRZ, it adds the name of the brain and the date that that BRZ was created. So I'm about to make a lot of sweeping changes in this particular brain. This is my real brain. So great, I've got that backup. I'm not worried at all. I could delete everything and still know that I can recover that data from this BRZ backup that I've made. So let's go ahead and start making those changes. And as we mentioned, today is holiday themed. So my family celebrates Christmas and I've got a lot of content. I keep track of vacations, birthdays. Thanksgiving is a big, big holiday in my family. My boys are, they like to eat. I don't know a better way to say it. I keep track of recipes and activities, 5K, you know, turkey trots, things like that. The holidays are no different. I keep track of, you know, our holiday cards that my family sends out, and of course, gift ideas and so forth. Now, how do I keep track of gift ideas in my brain? Throughout the year, when someone mentions, boy, I wish I had a new bike helmet, or I wish I had a book that was, you know, all about how to play Mahjong or something like that, I'll say, you know, thanks, Grandma. That's some good for me to know. I'll keep that in mind. And I come back to my brain and I either make a note of it, a thought, I find the product. I don't necessarily buy it right there on the spot, but I end up building this area out within my brain and I know who everything is specifically for. But as you can see, over time, it's become a little bit unwieldy. So I've got all of these different thoughts. The thoughts are associated with different people. They are, some of them I've purchased, some of them I haven't. If I had to really quickly find the Mahjong set that my mother is interested in, there it is, Mahjong set. So it just takes a second. It's in there, but it's have I bought it yet? I don't know yet. My own organic brain is remembering whether I have or not. Let's clean this area up. So the first thing I want to do is to create a new thought type for items that I have already purchased. I have purchased my mother this Mahjong set. So it's a vintage Mahjong set. As you can see, it's marked as sold. I'm actually going to click. There's different ways. I could right click and go through the context menu, or I can select from the drop down menu, and I'm going to create a new thought type, a new category for thoughts. Now, again, here I'm looking at thoughts, items that I've purchased or I haven't purchased yet. And there's going to be one other category in this area as well. But this could apply to anything within your brain, a project that you're working on. It's completed, it's not completed. It's researched, it's not fully researched. It's in phase one, phase two, phase three. So applicable to many, many different brains, different data structures in different ways. So here I'm going to create a thought type for purchased. And I will be able to keep track of all purchased items. What do I want my purchased items to look like? I'm going to click on the purchased thought type thought and click and add an icon. So select stock icon. I am going to do a search for a check mark. Great. So I know that that has been purchased. And maybe I want all of my purchased items to appear with this light green text. So it's going to be a lot easier to see that that item has been purchased. I'm actually getting ahead of myself. I want to arrange my thoughts by name first because I want to show you the advantage of thought arrangement as well. So let's start applying all of, you know, this purchased thought type to all of the purchased items. As soon as I know something is purchased, I can right click on the thought and I can set that thought type to purchased. That's going to be a little time consuming to go through one by one, set thought type. Yes, I've purchased that. So here's my shortcut. I'm going to start control clicking on some thoughts. I've taken care of all my mountain biking things and the Colorado hat. The cello box is done. Whoops, control click. And I'm control clicking on things that I have already purchased. Now I'm scrolling over to the right and that yard thing that I purchased, Laura's French onion oven. There's the Phoenix tea, the other Mahjong. Great. So I'm just control clicking. If you're on a Mac, this is a command click. And it simply adds all of, I've got that. I simply adds the desired thoughts to your selection box. Now there's a lot that you can do with the selection box. We could spend an entire webinar talking about all the different features that are available. I did this by control clicking thought by thought. You can control click on a gate. You can control click, I'll use this feature later. I'll control click on one thought and say, all right, brain, select all childward thoughts for 5, 6, 10, 20 generations down and add all of those to the selection box. So you can build up the selection box and modify thoughts in mass within your brain. So I can right click and there's so much that I can do here. I won't have time to share all of this with you, whether I'm copying these thoughts into another brain, I'm forgetting all of these thoughts at once, I'm merging them all together into one thought, or I'm unlinking them from this area and moving them to another. For today's example, I'm gonna change their thought type. So all of these thoughts that I've selected are now purchased thought types. And I can start to more clearly see all the gift ideas, items that I have purchased. What's the opposite of that? Things that I have not purchased yet. I have not purchased my baby Yoda yet. So I am going to alt click and drop down my thought type menu and say not purchased. And this is going to be a new thought type. Baby Yoda has not been purchased. And so I'm going to go to, oh no, and I just saw that's a problem that it's no longer available. We'll get to that later. So not purchased, I'm going to select another icon. Again, just an easy identifier. Let's see if X, EX, does that find anything? I want to do a red, maybe not purchased. I want this little red card. Since I've got soccer on the mind. Great, that's gonna be, oh, and I'll change the thought color as well. So again, anything you modify to this thought type, all thoughts that are applied to that type, they're going to inherit those properties, unless they have their own unique properties that you've assigned on the thought level itself. But that's gonna be nice and easily identifiable. And now I can simply go through once again, control, click, and it adds it into the selection box, and I can go through and find, whoops, I just did a regular click. I didn't have control down yet. I can control click on all of the thoughts that I'd like to apply this thought type to. Oh, that's a big one. I need to definitely take care of that. So I'm actually reminding myself mentally of all the things that I have not taken care of yet. So this is good. So right click, and I am going to set all of those thought types to not purchased. And then the final category, you can see I've got just simply a link to Amazon, Target, REI, Cabela's, IKEA. So Place, Wheel, and Sprocket, you might not be familiar with them. These are places where I do tend to do a lot of shopping for gift ideas. And those are simply going to be, again, I'll alt click on one of those, open up the selection, the thought properties display, and assign this thought type to, this is a shopping site. And that is a new type. And I want to modify what a shopping site thought will look like. Stock icon, I guess I'm gonna type in money. So there, I'll just give a little coin to it and also apply a color code to that text. Great, and now that's my final component. I'm gonna go into my Christmas gifts and control click on all of the shopping sites. I think there were a few more. There's Target and Wheel and Sprocket. I right click and set thought types. So you can see I've spent about shopping site. I've spent, how long have we been on the call? Maybe 10 minutes now. And I've got a nice visual. So I know if I've purchased it yet, there I missed one, REI. I'm going to right click and set type to shopping site. The advantage here is not only visually, if I see it's green, then I've already taken care of it. Red, I need to look into this. I've only got a few days left. But also, here's another great way to clean up your brain. I can right click and arrange thoughts. Rather than having them alphabetical in this list, I can arrange thoughts by their type. All of my unpurchased items are appearing together. Purchased items, those are all grouped together, and then my shopping sites. So very, very easily identifiable from here of what's been completed, what hasn't, and what my next steps are. Now, one more step that I'd like to take is to redefine these categories. So I'm simply going to say these are items for my family, items for my friends, and let's do the comma trick, family, comma, and then a semicolon. Those of you that have taken a 101 class know that the semicolon adds multiple individual thoughts at one time. The comma is actually going to grab the parent name and append it onto the name of the new thought. So this thought is going to be called family gift Christmas ideas. Now friend. And I think that should be good. So families and friends and all of my family gift ideas. Once again, I'm going to control click. I'll just do a few of these really quickly. Mahjong, definitely. So I've added them to the selection box. I can right click and let's go back to Christmas ideas. Right click and I can unlink those from their currently linked thought. So they're all linked to Christmas gifts. And I can go to my family thought and I can right click and I can link those. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7 thoughts. Those are family gift ideas, and those fall under the family thought under Christmas gift ideas. And if I do another one for friends, oops, I've already created the friends thought. I'm sorry, let me just hit escape. There's my friend. Once again, just because they're right here, I can click and drag, which is incredibly easy, but I can also hold down that control key and I can click and drag a box around a grouping of thoughts to add all of those to the selection box. So not that cello box, but here, clipless petals. These are some gift ideas that I have as well. And I can, to my Christmas gifts, right click and unlink. And I move down to friends. Now, maybe, hopefully you're seeing now why I created that backup. If I accidentally unlink everything and then leave this brain, or I accidentally right click forget, or do some massive change to a lot of thoughts at one time. You know, typically you can click on edit, undo, but if I've moved on to other things, synced my brain and so forth, oh, wait a minute, I deleted 100 thoughts out of my brain that I actually need for another project. You can always roll back to those that particular backup. So in this case, I right click and I'm gonna link those as children of friend. And so I'm really starting to clean things up. I just have a few more that I missed. I saw that cello box, that's under family. So is the fly reel. And the rest are all of my shopping sites. So now I've got my family and friend gift ideas, and then my different shopping sites. I could put them under a thought or move them up. Control click, move them up to be jump thoughts. I could right click, unlink, and then right click, move them as jump thoughts. I can maybe even just pick the ones that I really like and use most often, leave those as jumps. So here in the past 10, maybe 12, 13 minutes, I've really cleaned up this messy area of my brain. I actually took a screenshot before I got started, just so you could see the before and after. And the before is simply a grouping of miscellaneous thoughts. I don't have that additional info, whether it's been purchased or not. I've got to click and navigate around, or I don't remember who it's for. So I spend a little bit of time cleaning those up. I easily have access to my friend ideas and family ideas. And I've got just 2 or 3 days left to go in here and see if I can take care of making a few more purchases that I'm interested in doing for my holiday gift ideas. So the next step I want to share with you is quite simply, you know, creating those thought types and also thought tags. We'll be doing a little bit of that today as well. It's a great idea to take the time at the end of the year to clean up your thought type and tag lists. I just created 3 new thought types. Now, luckily they're all grouped together here, not purchased, and shopping. I'll start with letters that are pretty similar. So they're all 3 in a row, but still they're blending in with all these other different categories that I'm keeping track of. I'm going to create, just to make things super, super tidy, I'm going to make a category simply called gifts. So that's going to be a new thought type. And the child thoughts are going to be my purchased and my not purchased. And I'll just select it and then use the semicolon to create another thought. It was my shopping site. There we go. So I've linked those as child thoughts under this new category as gifts. You could think of this as a supertype and subtypes. And now when I view all of my different thought types, I've got them nested. You can see I'm working on an old VW, rebuilding engine parts and cars and things like that. So interesting hobby that I like, and I keep track of all those under the VW thought type. I've got favorite websites, but specifically favorite house websites, things that I'm purchasing for my house, as opposed to purchasing for gift ideas for friends and family and things like that. So it's a really, really great idea to categorize with those subtypes and super types to get those things organized so you can navigate through your lists of thought types and thought tags very, very quickly and easily. We'll get to thought tags in just a little bit here today as well. The next thing, though, that I want to share with you is you saw that some of my thoughts have checklists. So Disney TV, family, Christmas, and there we go, my Christmas. This is mostly checked off. I've got one more item to do. I love using checklists in the brain. Now, we share checklists from time to time when we're simply talking about, keeping things organized within a brain, whether it's in a business environment, a recreational environment. I love to use checklists within the brain. The advantage to doing this, though, is not only to go to that thought. You see, I navigated all the way back to my Christmas gift list to see what checklist items that are really important that I still need to take care of. I can also run, if I click on this little button here, right next to the search box, I can look at my to-do list. So my to-do list is showing me all action items within my brain that are not yet complete. The to-do list, reviewing your to-do list particularly at the end of the year, is a great way to really refresh your brain, clean things up, so that you're starting the new year with a clean slate. And you know that everything has been reviewed. If it's still an unfinished item, you can then apply a thought type or a thought tag to that. That's an urgent action item to complete that task. You can see right at the top, I've got my Christmas thought, and it's going to be displaying in the most recently activated checklist. So I recently checked a few things off on my Christmas thought, and I can click here to go directly to that thought and see the full note in the content area. But I still need to send an activity email out that I do with all my friends, Polar Plunge. Maybe you're familiar with those. Need to collect my holiday cards. I actually have a tire appointment tonight at 6 p.m. So that's unchecked because that hasn't happened yet. And then making the Christmas Day lasagna, a tradition I do with my kids. So that has to get taken care of as well. If I scroll down a little bit, I get into my weekend checklist, kayak build, other activities that I'm doing. And this is a good time at the end of the year to go in and review all of these things on a particular project and really decide, am I going to do that? Or did I miss this? And maybe it needs to get checked off. I'm seeing one already. My template for the cockpit is already completed. I can check that off the list. Great. It's just a nice way to review everything that you need to do. And from time to time, I'll even find something where I say, you know what? I'm not going to do that. It's not that urgent. I thought it might be nice. In this case, it's sort of a recreational item. I don't think I'm going to do that. I can delete this if I don't want it. Or what I like to do from time to time, if it's still something that I thought about doing for a project, but I know that it's not going to happen, I no longer need it appearing in my checklist, I'll turn it into a bulleted item. So that is just, there's no reason, if everything else on this list gets checked off, that item would stay. Let me find another here, biking brake pads. I can come back to this and fix it later, but if I decide, you know what, I'm just simply not going to change these brake pads. They work fine. It's not that urgent. I did have this as an urgent action item, but I decide not to do it. Not a problem. I'm going to make those bulleted lists. And hopefully you noticed right there, it disappeared off of my checklist. So it's a great time to review all of your action items in your to-do list. Are you going to do it or not in the new year? If you are, great. Take the steps to draw some attention to that thought. Maybe you want to pin that thought or make it an urgent action item as well. But you can then just review that content and decide what you're going to change or do moving forward. Another thing that you can do, another really, really great tip, end of year review, is to simply run a couple of reports. Now, in reports, as you can see, I have a fairly large brain open. There's 6,900 thoughts in this particular brain. So it's pretty large. So I'm not going to do any large, massive changes to this particular thought. Let's come back to our holiday thought really quickly. So great, I've got an alphabetical listing of all the thoughts in this particular brain, but it's a great idea to review all of my forgotten thoughts. What is a forgotten thought? A forgotten thought is a thought that was on its way to being deleted, but you never finished deleting that thought. And you can see, this is my real brain. I've got 41 forgotten thoughts. I try really hard, actually, never to have any forgotten thoughts. It happens. I have a group of thoughts and I think I'm going to delete those. I forget them. I move on to another project and I never come back to it. Forgotten thoughts are still there in the brain. They're not permanently deleted yet. So I can click on any one of these thoughts. Let's see what I want to click on. Locations. What is location? I was looking for just a random word. Okay, so for this example, these are locations for a Mexican grocery store that that we have in town. There's several of them around town. I've got my go-to store that I absolutely love. We go there frequently. I don't need to know what the other locations are. So I deleted this particular, or I forgot this particular thought, but I never deleted it. Do I want to remember it, reactivate it? I could right click and it'll just take you to this location's thought so I can see where they're all located. Actually, we're on it right now so I can see where all the different locations are for this particular grocery store. Again, I always go to the same one. I don't need this thought. So instead of right clicking and remembering this thought, great, I can permanently delete that thought. And if I refresh, over here, it looks like it already refreshed. Locations is no longer appearing in my forgotten thought list. So what I encourage you to do is, if you just have a few, if you've got under 50 or something like that, you might want to meticulously review. Doesn't matter how many you have. You might want to review and just, you know, click on these, the best hikes where. These are camping in a particular area that I like to go. Custom build for a different type of kayak I was interested in doing. It never went off the took off the ground, so I can delete those thoughts. If I review everything and I just want a clean house, I can click over here and select delete all forgotten thoughts. It'll delete all of these 40 forgotten thoughts and clean my brain up just a little bit. So I've got, again, fresh start for the new year. I have not reviewed these and I did not expect to see so many forgotten thoughts. So I am going to be visiting these one by one. This thought I can delete. So I right click and select to delete the best hikes. I don't need that one either. I didn't even have any content on that thought. So I right click and I can delete that thought. So I'm down to 38. Few more to do in my end of year review. Another really, really great end of year review is to view your thoughts by the date modified. Now, this is a big brain, so this may be take a little bit to, there we go. Refresh, that was not date modified, that was still alphabetical. So we'll let that refresh. And once you have your thoughts by date viewed by date modified, I suggest that you scroll down to the very, very end of the list. Now, again, I've got close to 7,000 thoughts in this brain, so it just takes a little bit to refresh this list. but scroll down to the very bottom of your dates modified. If you haven't been to that thought in a long time, maybe there's a reason for that. You're not visiting that area of your brain. You no longer need that content. Maybe it's in the wrong area of your brain. So this is still going alphabetical. So my apologies. Oh no, it's not alphabetical. It's there we go, date modified. So I scroll down to the bottom of the list. These are the thoughts that I haven't visited or modified, made any changes to in a long time. So I can click and go to that thought. This is, I sort of like to collect vintage Hawaiian shirts. I'm gonna leave that. I'm not gonna do anything with it. I've got a thought called sheesh. Oh, it's just simply misspelled. That should be called fish. So that's a perfect example of, you know, content that maybe that's why I haven't been there in a while, because I'm doing a search for grilling fish recipes and it was misspelled as sheesh in my brain for whatever reason. So I simply needed to fix it. So that falls under cooking, under my food thought for me. So a really, really great review to going, you know, how far back you want to go is completely dependent on how many thoughts you have and is completely up to you, but it's a really great way, once again, to review your content at the end of the year. So the next thought that I wanted to share with you is we talked a little bit about thought types, thought tags. Let's say, once again, you review your content, you've got a checklist that's not done and you want to bring some attention to that. I have a thought tag that I simply call urgent. I classify things either as urgent, medium priority, or maybe they're on the back burner. But my urgent action items are things that I need to take care of sooner rather than later. And I highly suggest that you create some type of thought tag with this priority level. And the reason why I call it a priority level is because people call it different things. I used to call this hot items, action items, what have you. Now I just simply call it urgent. That works for me. I know a lot of people that utilize this type of urgency level within their brain. They call it different things, tier one, tier two, tier three. So I just simply call it urgent. What are my urgent action items? Well, you saw earlier, and I actually do need to fix the brake pads on one bike because it's important that bikes are able to stop. So I'm going to change that back. I'll show you how I would have found this later to fix it after the fact, but I'll simply change that. I've ordered them, but I haven't removed the new ones and gotten made further progress yet. But it's still an urgent action item. So why does this benefit me? Because at the end of, or at the beginning of every week, or at the beginning of the day, I can go to my tags list and show all of my urgent action items, and I know what my priorities are. In my business brain, this is just a crucial, crucial component of my business brain. So I know, you know, these are tasks that are, you know, due soon or that has been recently assigned to me that I simply need to take keep track of. And they're all grouped together, as you can see, under the urgent tag when I go to the tag thought. But when I go to just to the individual thought, let's go to Dream Bikes. So Dream Bikes is a local charity. It actually falls under NICA, National Intergalactic Cycling Association, which I am a member of and so forth. But sometimes I purchase old bikes and fix them up. Sometimes I donate bikes that I have fixed up. So I've got a couple of bikes that need to be donated, and so I need to take care of that. And now at the holiday season is a great time to do that. So that's an example of an urgent action item. Another is making a doctor's appointment. I'm not gonna click on that thought because I've got a lot of personal information there, but it's time for a checkup. I need to make a doctor's appointment. There's some things I need to do with my car. Christmas gift ideas, I need to finish that list. So I've marked that as an urgent action item. So it really, really helps in so many ways throughout your brain to create this very, very simple sort of urgency level. If I get all these completed, I can start working on my medium priority and back burner action items as well. So it really, really simply helps. And I was going to go down, I know one Christmas gift idea, actually, if I go into friends, things that I have not purchased yet, I'm looking for a vintage looking watch. It could be sort of a fun watch, but that is sort of something that I want to get taken care of for a special friend. So I'm just going to right click on that, and I'm going to make this a go up to my tag, make it an urgent action item. And so tonight after work, when I'm saying, all right, here's everything that needs to get done as far as, you know, being ready for the holidays, first thing I'm going to do is go to that urgent action item tag and take care of that list. And now you can see my vintage looking watch is there and ready for me to take care of. Another thing that I need to do, and I'm going to start wrapping things up so we have plenty of time for QA today. Another thing that I need to take care of actually are my holiday cards. And this leads me into a sort of another entire feature of the brain that, again, I could spend an entire webinar talking about this one feature. It's I love it so much. It's the brain box. So I came to a thought called holiday cards, and I've got everything all ready to go, but I still have my 2020 holiday card up there. My wife took care of 2021. I'm taking care of 2022. That's how we work. We trade off year to year on who picks the holiday card. So I've picked the holiday card. Where did I pick it? I picked it from my phone. I took the picture on my phone, and from my phone, if the question comes up in the QA portion of today's webinar, I'll open up my phone and present it on the screen. But anytime you install your the brain for iOS on your iPhone or even Android, or here on the desktop, we have a feature called Brain Box. And Brain Box is a super, super easy way to send data out to your brain to be classified and organized at a later date. So my final tip to you is, if you utilize Brain Box, and I encourage you to use it, now's a good time to clean house. So again, you've got a clean Brain Box list for the new year. You don't want your brain box to be a junk drawer of a bunch of thoughts that have not yet found a home within your brain. By the end of the year, mine is starting to turn into that. So it's a great time to do a review. So here's my brain box. I click. These are all the thoughts that I have in my brain box. And they need to find a home somewhere in my brain. Right here at the top is this image. And you can add it to a thought, link it to the active thought, create a new child thought, or preview it. So I'll click on preview. It's going to be a picture of me with my family and my dog. This is going to be our holiday card this year. And so I'm going to add this thought to, oops, I got my screenshot was up there on my brain. So I'm going to add this image to my holiday cards. So I'm going to click the little paperclip icon. And there, I've added that image to this particular thought. And I can very easily, I know that one was 2020, this one I can rename, I'll right click and just simply rename it to 2022. Great, so I've got my image there and now I'm one step closer to printing these out and sending them out and so forth and cleaning up my brain box. So it's just a really, really, again, just a great opportunity to go in, review all of the content in your brain. You can preview one by one, so I can open images and see what they are. This one, it opened on another monitor. So this is an image of, again, I like to work on vintage bikes. So that's a bike that I recently worked on. And you can then navigate to that particular thought and add this as an attachment. So I open up my brain box and I think it was this one. I'll simply add that. Oh, I already have it open. Sorry, I left it open. So I can go back in, close it, and add this this particular thought in as an attachment to this thought. There, I just did it. So I've got that. I found a home for that particular thought. So cleaning out your brain box, really, really, again, great activity to review content that doesn't have a home yet in your brain. You know, we covered today rearranging thoughts and content, reviewing it through reports, your to-do lists, and so forth. But what about all that content that you started to, you know, get into your brain, but it never made it there, never found a home? Those are your brain box items that you can clean up. And actually, the final component that I'll share with you, I'm going to go back to my holiday thought. And, you know, I've shared this before. I keep a lot of different brain databases for different topics. I like smaller topic-specific brains. What if I decide I want to create just a holiday brain and start keeping track of all of my Christmas gift shopping and everything in my holiday brain? To do that, I am going to control click. I'm going to share some features, but I'm going to start moving a little faster now. These are features we reviewed today with a twist. I control click on just the Christmas thought, and now I click on edit and select related thoughts. So from the Christmas thought, I'm going to just go down childward thoughts. I don't need all this past Christmases. I archive all my old Christmas gift ideas and lists and things like that. I'm just going to go down from here for 10 generations away. I don't think I've got too much down below. We're going to find out. And I'm going to add anything within 10 generations down into my selection box. So there you can see I've got 95 thoughts that I just added into my selection box. And from here, I can right click and copy those 95 thoughts onto my clipboard. And now I can click on file and select to create a new brain. And I'll just call this my new Christmas brain. And I'm just going to say, okay. This will create a new brain, and I'm basically starting with a blank slate. It selected randomly one of my different wallpapers here. Let's just go down to, well, we'll find something later. I don't think I'm gonna find anything too Christmassy. So I'll just create a nice light background. I still have those 95 thoughts on my clipboard. I can right click and paste those into another brain. So that question comes up quite a bit. How do I take a massive brain and take a branch, a grouping of thoughts that I've selected and make a new brain that I can safely share with my client or with a fellow colleague, but without all my personal banking information linked into it? I've just taken, my other brain had close to 7,000 thoughts. I've just copied almost 100 of them into this particular brain, and everything is there, all the different thought types, the tags. You can see these light colors don't appear too well on the lighter background. I can go back into my brain theme and change to a darker background if that'll look better. But now moving forward, I can start keeping track of all this data here in this particular brain, a separate brain from my original, from the primary brain where I keep all my data. And then the follow-up question to that is typically, how do you merge two brains together? That's simply done with a BRZ. So if I wanted to merge my entire Lore Bloom brain, which I've already got a portion of it, but let's say I wanted to bring that into this brain. If I say file, import, I can import a BRZ, either as a new brain. In this case, I would want to import it into my new Christmas brain. And then I've merged those two brains. So we've also learned how to segment a very large primary brain into smaller topic specific brains, or even merge those back together. So with that, we're coming up towards the end of the hour. I want to thank everyone for joining me today, but please do stay on for answering a couple of questions. Chase, I'll invite you to come onto the call and ask you if we had any interesting features, additional features that someone wanted to see during the QA.
Sure, absolutely. I guess the first one up here, could you show the difference between using a type and a tag for marking something as purchased or not purchased?
Sure, absolutely. So types and tags can be used in so many different ways. Let's get back into my real brain here. But the key thing to keep in mind is that a type is you can only apply one type to a thought, where you can apply multiple tags to a thought. So if I go down into my gift ideas and I'm going into my family, and here I've got this chef knife thought that also falls under other areas of my brain, as you can see, and I've got notes on different types and things down below. But this particular thought is not purchased. So I want that to be the not purchased thought type. But the tag for this thought is and can be urgent. I only have 3 days left to do it. So this is an urgent action item. I'm keeping track of my expenses. This is an expensive action item. And my tags are just different. I've got different tags depending on, you know, different components of what I'm interested in or categories that I have. Let's say this is one of my favorite. This would be a gift for my wife, one of my favorite people. So I'm going to say that's a favorite item as well. So I've got three tags associated with this thought, but the thought type is that it's a not purchase, it's an unpurchased gift idea. So that's my sort of setting of thought types and tags. The thing to keep in mind, only one thought type per thought, whereas you have multiple tags. So if I'm reviewing my tags, whether I'm reviewing things that are expensive that I need to take care of, this is a penny farthing is a type of bike, that a vintage bike that I'm interested in building. So that falls under bikes and so forth. It would be a very expensive project. Therefore, it's a sort of a jump thought, a side thought off of the vintage bikes that I do build, but it's expensive. So I simply tagged it as expensive. And this kitchen knife would also qualify as expensive, but it's also urgent. I need to make a decision. Am I going to get it or not right away and so forth? So multiple tags, individual, one individual thought type. As long as you know that, you can decide exactly how you are going to use those two features together. Some people use one or the other. Some people use combinations of both. I've seen people that they're urgent action items. It's not a tag, it's a thought type. And if that works for your scenario, then go right ahead. It's really up to you how to utilize those features.
Fantastic. And next one up here, when would you tend to make an action item a thought versus, for example, a checkbox and a note?
Sure. It really, really depends, I guess. And sometimes they're actually both. So it's a checklist item, but also there's details on where I'm going to purchase it. If it's just something that I need to do and it doesn't have a web page associated with it, it doesn't have any parts or anything like that. Like in this case, hang the outdoor lights. I don't have any videos on hanging my outdoor holiday lights. I don't need to purchase any holiday outdoor lights. It's just a task that needs to be completed for my 2022 holiday task list. So it simply gets a checklist item in the notes. However, making lasagna, there's a lot that goes into lasagna. I need to go grocery shopping and so forth. So in this case, it's actually kind of both. And I'll show you what I mean. It's a checklist item, but also notice it's underlined in blue. This is a feature that I didn't even get into today called unlinked mentions. This means by being underlined in blue that there is a thought called lasagna elsewhere in this brain. And if I right click, I can either activate this thought or make a permanent link to this thought. I'll go ahead and activate it. And there's my lasagna thought. And it has a checklist. I've already been here, so I know what ingredients I have and what I need to get to the store and purchase. So again, checklist, but in this case, they don't have any thoughts as being action items. They're just things that it's basically a grocery list for me. So once again, it's a personal choice whether you decide to make it an urgent action item as a standalone thought in the brain, or you're breaking down a process and it doesn't need any further explanation other than, you know, I better have a 6-ounce can of tomato paste. So it's just simply a checklist item in my brain.
Perfect. And next one up here, do we have time for one more or two more?
Yeah, two more would be great.
Okay, great. Yeah. Could you provide some examples where assigning colors and labels to links might be useful?
Sure. I wonder if I use that feature quite a bit in this particular brain. I'm just going to go ahead and find one. Colors in links, I use this in my professional brain, my business brain, and I simply utilize green means go, red means stop. That kind of works for me. Every now and then I'm identifying, you know, who's doing what. For a particular project. So let's say for my kayak build, it's very important that I build some new sawhorses for this particular project. I can click on the link between the two thoughts, and there's different ways to draw some attention to it. First, I'll make a directional link. So when I hover over, I get the nice little animation, as you can see there, and there's an arrow. It's, you know, this is my next project, and I can even title it next. I'll give it a green link so it starts to stand out. Let's make that color a little bigger. And I'll even make this link a little bit thicker. So you can really play around with this to get the visual that you need. And now I can see next up for my kayak build is going to be building some new sawhorses when I either hover over the kayak build thought or hover over the link itself. I get that nice visual animation. And I know that that's the next step in this particular process. I actually have a thought called next, which gives me a video of what I'm building next. But you know, these are some great options as well. Again, in my own recreational brain, I don't utilize a lot of those link colors or link labels or link directions. That's more in my business brain. And the direction can sometimes mean let's say Chase and I were working on a project together. I'm in charge of graphics. So linking up to all the graphics is I've got directional links from my thought. Chase is in charge of all the programming and engineering and JavaScript and so forth. So all of the data and information that I'm keeping track of that has to do with sort of behind the scenes engineering, those are going to be linked to Chase. And with maybe a directional arrow. And you know, one process is under review, whereas another process is approved, or you know, some functionality that we tested isn't working with the type of backend that we're running, or the type of SQL that we have, or whatever the case may be. So sometimes that can provide a lot of additional information. And this is the important thing to point out. It's information that's not on necessarily on the thought, one thought or the other. It's on the relationship between the two thoughts. That's quite often when I'm using a link label or a link direction or a link color. It's about the relationship between those two items, not specifically about one or the other. Hopefully that that information helps to answer that question, but it's certainly something to a more advanced feature. So appropriate to ask about today, and something that you should certainly play around with and find it, see if you can find a system that works best for you.
Awesome. And one last question here.
Sure, great.
Could you show how one would navigate around the Plex while primarily using the keyboard instead of a mouse?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I use the mouse. No surprise there. But I know there are people that use the keyboard, and the brain is incredibly capable of being utilized both navigating through and activating thoughts, launching attachments, but as well as creating new content and actually moving on and using the brain on a daily basis. It can be used without a mouse. So first I'll share with you that there are some built-in keyboard shortcuts. The one that Chase is referring to, navigating, not a problem. I simply use the arrow keys on my keyboard. So always think of, you know, you're starting from the current active thought. So I've got an active thought called kayak build. If I click the down arrow, notice I get a nice little highlighted circle, and I'm over to the right now, clicking up on the keyboard. So enter on supplies. Supplies is now the active thought, and I want to review my US composites order. There was an attachment here, and I click enter again, and it's going to open up the thought properties display for that thought. If I want to rename this, hit escape. So a lot that you can do with the keyboard. I haven't touched the mouse and want to continue navigating up, enter, up, over to the right, enter, up, and we're right back to kayak build. Now, to add even more functionality to toggle through, you know, different panes and action items, actionable items that you see in drop-down menus and so forth, you can check out, if you go to options preferences, on a Mac, you would click on the brain preferences, and I'm gonna expand everything here. These are all of the different keyboard shortcuts that you can create. So if you do not typically use the mouse and you're more of a keyboard user, I highly encourage you to start filling out this list of available keyboard shortcuts. And you know, some of them you might not need. Some of them are features that you use more than you know someone else would, such as how do you minimize the window or merge thoughts or swap splitter panes. You know, that makes the Plex go over on the right and the notes on the left and so forth, zoom in and out of the Plex. Some of those don't have default keyboard shortcuts associated with them, so you can create your own depending on what features you use most often and start using the keyboard to navigate and manipulate, utilize the Brain application. So with that, thank you so much for all of the curious questions that always take us in a new direction. Thank you for joining me today for the Brain 202. Again, I went through a few more advanced features of the application. If this is your first introduction into the Brain, I don't always wear the hat, and the Abominable doesn't always join us, but we are always available once a week on the Brain 101. Actually, next week we'll have the week off for the holiday season in between the two holidays. But again, starting up in January, we've got a Brain 101 this Thursday, and starting up in January, pretty much every Friday, Brain 101 class. And we go over all the basic features, creating thoughts, unlinking, relinking, and so forth, adding content into the notes and content area, and file attachments as well. I encourage you to join us for a Brain 101 class. Also, at any point, if you have another question, more advanced feature of the Brain, you want to talk in more in depth about importing different file types, so forth, whatever the case may be, you can write into us, support@thebrain.com. We're happy to hear from you. And of course, if you ever visit our website, there's a button in the lower right-hand corner. And during business hours, we're open from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. Monday through Friday Pacific time. During business hours, you can click on that button and communicate with a real human being, not a bot. We're happy to answer any additional questions that you may have. So on behalf of Chase and myself, thank you for joining us. Always a pleasure to share more features of the Brain to the Brain user community. Again, we're happy to hear from you. support@thebrain.com in the future if you want to contact us. Have a wonderful, safe holiday season, and as always, enjoy your brain. Thanks, everyone. Bye.